Hi there, everyone, and welcome to The Daily Gardener, and thank you for listening. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling. It's the 4th of July. Today, we celebrate what I'm calling Dependence Day for gardeners, and we'll also learn about the gutta percha pioneer. It's a fascinating story. We celebrate the California botanist who's remembered with a plant name and the name of a canyon, and she was a tremendous conservationist. We also celebrate a botanist who is a sentimental favorite of mine. She died while collecting samples in the Western Himalayas almost 80 years ago today. And we honor National Meadows Day with some poetry. It's an annual celebration of the wildflower meadows of England. Today, we grow that garden library with a fiction book that was the winner of the Man Asian Literary Prize. And the main character finds solace among the jungle-fringed tea plantations of the Cameron Highlands. And she also meets some incredible gardeners. And then we'll wrap things up with the flowers that were presented to President Calvin Coolidge in 1924. It was his birthday. One newspaper headline said, "Cal's cool in 52. Didn't exactly rhyme, but that was the headline. But first, let's catch up on some greetings from gardeners from around the world in today's curated news. First up is a post from Erica V. in Ohio. She's holding a brand new rosemary plant, and she says, "Happy birthday to me. My secret to growing lavender and rosemary in pots is to use terracotta. Don't overwater them and put them in full sun." That's great advice. And then Elena Austin shared some before and after pictures of her garden. She transformed her neglected backyard into a garden and a play area for her children. Very nice. And then Joanne Steele wrote in and said, "I love that people are beginning to discover the fitness benefits of gardening." She writes, "When I garden, I'm not only escaping from the world, growing my own food, I'm also giving myself a workout. Grow a garden." That's great advice. And then finally, Teresa Christie wrote in to say, "The lilies are blooming. The lilies are blooming." She bought her lilies on clearance last year, and this summer, she has a beautiful display of deep red lilies. And I have to say, it's hard not to fall in love with lilies this time of year. July is their month, that's for sure. All right. If you'd like to participate in the Gardener Greetings segment, send in your garden pics, stories, birthday, anniversary wishes, and so forth to jennifer@thedailygardener.org. And to listen to the show while you're at home, just ask your smart speaker to play the Daily Gardener podcast. Alexa and Google both know how to do that, and it's just that easy. Here's today's curated news. Shauna Coronado recently wrote a post called "Just Moved? Build a temporary garden at your new home." This is such a great idea, and she makes some great points. In fact, Shauna herself just moved, and she writes, "It's a smart plan to set up a temporary garden at your new home when you've just moved because you don't really understand the lay of the land in your garden yet. Understanding your garden," she writes, "takes at least a year." A year? Yes, a year. An example of this is that the sunshine changes throughout your garden. In the winter, you might have the direct sun in some places, creating microclimates, while in the summer, you could have the opposite. Understanding your sun, water, and other conditions on your property takes a while. Well, I couldn't agree with Shauna more. You know, we've had this place here by the lake in Wyoming for 2 years, and I only just started working on my garden now, which was my plan all along, but the pandemic kind of accelerated that. And I have to say that I'm glad that I waited, and I'm glad that I did get to know the lay of the land here, because it's completely different than back home in Maple Grove. The soil here is sandy, and it's acidic. We have pine trees galore. And of course, when you move, the house tends to take priority. And so all the while I was furnishing the rooms here and getting the kids set up, getting the office set up, getting the kitchen set up, I was planning and scheming all of the things that I wanted to do in my garden. And I really like Shauna's idea of a temporary garden. In fact, I have that right now. I've got a few plants and shrubs that I don't have the home for just yet, and we have some renovation going on outside. But as soon as that's done, those plants are going to move out of the temporary garden and find their new permanent home on the property. And I can't wait. So great post by Shauna. And if you'd like to read this post for yourself, there's a ton of ideas here. All you have to do is search for the word temporary in the Facebook group for the show, and this post will pop right up. Next up is a post that I wrote for today on the blog, and it's called No Independence Day for Gardeners. Here's what it says. Today we celebrate what I'm calling Dependence Day for Gardeners, and here's why. Gardeners are a passionate lot. They're some of the best people I know. Maybe it's because gardening requires so much patience, hope, and love, characteristics of good people. And although gardeners enjoy puttering about in their gardens, what they really love is to share their passion for and experience of gardening with others. If you're new to gardening, and many folks are thanks to the pandemic, you will likely be happily helped by other gardeners. Simply put, gardeners need other gardeners. When I was a new gardener, I remember eagerly seeking out other gardeners for advice. This is no quick process. First, you ask a question. Then that question leads to a cross-examination by your fellow gardener. Thanks to smartphones, pictures may be shared, along with promises to follow up. If you get lucky, you might even find yourself on a quick tour of a garden. And often, what I thought would be a quick exchange of ideas turned into something far greater: friendship, membership, or a new job. My point is that everything about gardening is 100% relational between other gardeners and us, and between us and our gardens. When we garden, we are surrounded by life, from the microbes in the soil to the birds in the sky. The garden is a gift. It's a place to find connection, and I never feel less alone than when I'm in my garden. There will be times when you hear or read that gardening is a solitary activity. Nothing could be further from the truth. To me, that's like saying prayer is a solitary activity. In many ways, gardening is prayer. Christiane Amanpour recently interviewed psychiatrist Sue Stewart Smith, the author of The Well-Gardened Mind, and Los Angeles gardener Ron Finley, known as the Gangster Gardener. The interview took place as the world was first locking down in response to COVID-19. And the topic of the interview was the healing, grounding, and restorative power of gardening. Sue and Ron both recognize that gardening not only sustains us physically through exercise and food, but also supports our emotional and mental well-being. If 2020 has taught me anything, it's how much we depend on each other. I've had the pleasure of helping new gardeners and of seeing the wonder of gardening through their eyes. I put out a plea for rhubarb on Nextdoor, and as per usual, I not only received 2 clumps of rhubarb, but a new friend, info on a local garden center, and an invitation to join a new garden club. Thanks, Sue. As for my garden, I've enjoyed another spring planting favorite herbs in a kitchen garden here at the cabin, a place I have never gardened. My cabin garden grows beside some trees that were part of an old-growth pine forest. And when I'm outside, I delight in the company of countless dragonflies and birds. The duck and geese parade along the shoreline in the backyard every evening. And there's a little loon family that I especially enjoy all day long. Gardening in the shadow of so much nature has flipped my script. Before the pandemic, I'd often comment on how much my garden needed me. The weeding, the planting, the feeding, the pruning, the dreaming. Today, I can only think about how much we need gardening for the restoration, the grounding, the nourishment, and the fortification. That's why today we should be honoring our Dependence Day on the planet, on the land, and yes, on our gardens. All right, that's it for today's gardening news. Now, if you'd like to check out my curated news articles and original blog posts for yourself, you're in luck, because I share all of it with the listener community in the free Facebook group for the show. It's called the Daily Gardener Community, and you'll find it on Facebook. So there's no need to take notes or search for links. The next time you're on Facebook, just search for Daily Gardener Community and request to join. I'd love to meet you in the group. Here's today's brevities. Today is the birthday of the gutta percha pioneer Henry Bewley, who was born on this day in 1804 in Dublin. Bewley's first job was manufacturing soda water. His work with soda got him in touch with Charles Hancock, who was eager to develop a stopper for bottles. Hancock's solution came to him in the form of gutta percha, a tough, rubber-like substance that had been discovered in the sap of Malaysian trees and brought to England in the mid-1840s. After Hancock showed Bewley the gutta percha, he set about inventing the machine that would extrude the gutta percha into tubing, which would ultimately find a purpose in dentistry and as an insulator for electrical wiring. Although their partnership would not last, Bewley and Hancock formed the Gutta Percha Company in London on February 4, 1845. 20 years later, Bewley's company was swept up in the merger that created the Telegraph Construction and Maintenance Company. Up until the mid-1900s, it was gutta percha that protected the transatlantic cables used for communication. The resin from gutta percha was used to make all kinds of items like buckets and mugs, soles for shoes, bands for heavy equipment, buoys, and so forth. Early on, the uses for gutta percha seemed endless, but its original use as tubing, thanks to Bewley, was vital for scientists and engineers working with wiring, liquids, and gases. And gardeners owe a debt of gratitude to Bewley. His gutta percha tubing was perfect for this in-demand item called a garden hose. I thought you might enjoy hearing a little excerpt from this 1854 advertisement for gutta percha. It features a testimony from a Mr. J. Farah, the gardener to a successful attorney who lived on the estate known as Holderness House near Hull. Farah said, "I have 400 feet of your gutta percha tubing in lengths of 100 feet each, and I have used them for the past 12 months for watering these gardens, and I find it better than anything I have ever yet tried. The pressure of the water is very considerable, but this has not the slightest effect on the tubing. I consider this tubing to be a most valuable invention for gardeners, as much as it enables us to water our gardens in about half the time and with half the labor formerly required." And it was on this day, on the 4th of July in 1976, a very hot day to go hiking, that the botanist Mary Dedecker made her way back to a spot in the desert of California where she had discovered a new plant earlier in June of that same year. And when Mary Dedecker reached the shrub, she was stunned. Mary remembers seeing the plant in full bloom. It was a gold profusion, and she fondly recalled it was just golden. All over the dark cliffs, these golden bunches from this shrub. Mary and her husband Paul lived in Independence for over 5 decades. Paul's job brought them to the town in California, and Mary remembered it was a different world up here. My husband would fish in the alpine lakes of the High Sierra, and I would sketch and make notes on plants. There was virtually no literature on the flora of the Eastern Sierra. Mary and Paul's Dedecker shrub became the only species in the brand new Dedecker genus, which was the first newly discovered genus in California in almost 3 decades. The Dedecker's shrub, the Dedecker eucariensis, is a member of the buckwheat family, and it's commonly referred to as July gold. It's a rare plant, and it's only found in California's Inyo and White Mountains. These mountains are remote, but they were well known by Paul and Mary, who loved to explore the desert and found it utterly enchanting. And they lived to see the naming of Dedecker Canyon, which was a unique honor. Believe it or not, there's a rule that geographic locations, unlike plants, cannot be named after living people. So in this case, the canyon was actually named after the Dedecker plant genus, which was named for Mary and Paul. But it clearly honored the couple all the same, and it was a sneaky way to get around the rules. As a little girl, Mary learned to garden from her dad, and he encouraged her to grow things. Her training as a botanist and her love of nature gave her the drive to search the desert floor on countless hikes in order to collect and catalog over 6,000 plant species. It's no wonder, then, that Mary successfully fought to preserve the Eureka Dunes, which are adjacent to the northwest corner of Death Valley. In Mary's lifetime, she was able to stop off-road vehicles from destroying the dunes. Regarding her 3-decades-long fight, she said, "It was terribly frustrating. I was sick as I went out and watched off-road vehicle users tear up the place, spinning out the plants and seedlings, destroying animal habitats. They would be all over the dunes, having the time of their lives, so unaware of the damage to the delicate and unique ecosystems." Much of Mary's work involved researching the flowers of the dunes. And thanks to Mary, the dunes became part of the over 500 nationally recognized natural landmarks in the United States. Mary Dedecker witnessed many impressive desert blooms during her lifetime. The beauty of the desert and the miraculous desert plant life never failed to hold her attention. Among her many published works, Mary was perfectly suited to write 2 books on California's desert flora. Today, young botanists may be surprised to learn that Mary never received any formal training. Yet Mary credited the help of countless botanists and the desert itself as her teachers. Through her devotion and fieldwork, Mary came to be regarded as one of the nation's top experts on plants of the northern Mojave Desert and Owens Valley. And there's an interesting side note to Mary's story. In 1945, while on one of her desert hikes, Mary discovered the remains of a Japanese-American named Matsumura, who had left an internment camp at Manzanar to go fishing with friends. He'd been missing for 1 month when Mary discovered his body. Authorities buried him in that spot, and then slowly the world forgot about his resting place. And for decades, people attempted to relocate his burial spot without any luck. His grave remained lost to time until it was rediscovered in 2019. And today we remember the English botanist Lady Joan Margaret Lagey, who died on this day in 1939 after she slipped and fell while collecting samples in the Western Himalayas at the Valley of Flowers in India. When she died, Lady Joan was 54 years old and unmarried, and she was the youngest daughter of the 6th Earl of Dartmouth. In addition to enjoying botany, Lady Joan served the poor through her local church. And in 1922, she was nominated for Sheriff of Staffordshire County, but her dad disqualified her on the grounds that she owned no property. Ironically, before traveling to the Valley of Flowers, Lady Joan had spent the previous 3 years tending to her sick father. Then she had spent the winter before her trip battling pneumonia. And although some of her friends were against her going to India, Lady Joan was eager to go, and many remarked that it was her first real holiday in 10 years. The Valley of Flowers was an exciting destination. It had only just been discovered in 1931, 8 years before Lady Joan's visit. Three English mountaineers stumbled on the valley after getting lost. The valley enchanted them, and the flowers made it seem like they were in a real live fairyland. One of the climbers was a botanist named Frank Smythe, and he wrote a book called Comet Conquered, and in it, he named the area the Valley of Flowers. The Valley of Flowers is a 7-day trip from Delhi. It's now a protected national park, and as the name implies, it is a lush area famous for the millions of alpine flowers that cover the hills and slopes and nestle along icy flowing streams. Throughout most of the year, the Valley of Flowers remains hidden, buried under several feet of snow throughout a 7 to 8 month long winter. In March, the melting snow and monsoons activate a new growing season, and there is a brief 3 to 4 month window when the Valley of Flowers is accessible, generally during the months of July, August, and September. The Valley of Flowers is home to over 500 varieties of wildflowers, and many are still considered rare. Along with daisies, poppies, and marigolds, there are primulas and orchids growing wild. The rare blue poppy, commonly known as the Himalayan Queen, is the most coveted plant in the valley. Now, Lady Joan ended up traveling to the Valley of Flowers as a direct result of Frank Smythe's book. Smythe's work inspired many, and it attracted the attention of Edinburgh's Royal Botanic Garden, and they sponsored Lady Joan's trip. After arriving in the Himalayas, Lady Joan was accompanied by guides and porters, and as she made her way over the lower foothills, she collected alpine specimens. On the day she died, Lady Joan was traversing the slopes of Koolyagarva, which still attracts tourists. After she fell, her porters recovered her body, and they buried her in the valley at the request of her older sister, Dorothy. All of Lady Joan's belongings were packed up and sent home to England. But the following summer, in 1940, Dorothy visited her sister's grave, and she placed a marker over the spot where she had been buried. Today, Lady Joan's marker is visited by tourists, and it includes poignant words from Psalm 121. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. In unearthed words, today in England, it's National Meadows Day, an annual celebration of the wildflower meadows of England. And every year, the event takes place on or around the first Saturday of July. So in tribute, here are some little poems about meadowsweet and meadows. This first one's from William Wordsworth, the English Romantic poet. How does the meadow flower its bloom unfold? Because the lovely little flower is free down to its root, and in that freedom, bold. This next one's from Christina Georgina Rossetti, the English poet, from her poem called In the Meadow, What in the Meadow? In the meadow, what in the meadow? Bluebells, buttercups, meadow sweet, and fairy rings for the children's feet in the meadow. In the garden, what in the garden? Jacob's ladder and Solomon's seal, and love lies bleeding beside all heal in the garden. Here's one from the Scottish poet Charles Mackay called Meadowsweet. Rose, we love thee for thy splendor. Lily, for thy queenly grace. Violet, for thy lowly merit, peeping from thy shady place. But mine airy woodland fairy, scattering odors at thy feet, no one knows thy modest beauty, no one loves thee, meadow sweet. And here's a poem called Meadow Sweet by Francis Wynne, the Irish poet. The meadow sweet was uplifting its plumelets of delicate hue. The clouds were all dreamily drifting above the blue. On the day when I broke from my tether and fled from the square in the street, was the day we went walking together in the meadow sweet. The meadow sweet with its clover and bright with its buttercups lay. The swallows kept eddying over, all flashing and gay. I remember a fairy-like feather sailed down your coming to greet the day we went walking together in the meadow sweet. Ah, the meadow sweet, and the singing of birds in the boughs overhead, I and your soft little hand to mine clinging, and the words that you said, when bold in the beautiful weather, I laid my love at your feet, the day we went walking together in the meadow sweet. And finally, here's a poem called Meadow Sweet by the English author and poet William Leonard Courtney. In summer fields, the meadow sweet spreads its white bloom around the feet of those who pass in love or play the golden hours of holiday. And heart to answering heart can beat where grows the simple meadow sweet, embosomed in some cool retreat. The long seed grasses bend to meet the stream that murmurs as it flows songs of forget-me-not and rose. The filmy haze of noontide heat is faint with scents of meadow sweet. Ah, love, do you know meadow sweet? Does some pale ghost of passion fleet adown this dreary lapse of years, so void of love, so full of fears? some ancient far-off echo greet the once-loved name of Meadowsweet. It's time to grow that garden library with today's book, The Garden of Evening Mists by Tan Twaning. This book came out in 2012. It's a great fiction book for gardeners this summer, and it won the Man Asian Literary Prize. Kirka's reviews said, "The unexpected relationship between a war-scarred woman and an exiled gardener leads to a journey through remorse to a kind of peace." This book is a 4.5-star rated book on Amazon. It's 352 pages, and it's the perfect summer read for gardeners. I love this book. You can get a copy of The Garden of Evening Mists by Tan Twaning and support the show by using the Amazon link in today's show notes for around $3. Finally, here's something sweet to revive the little botanic spark in your heart. On this day in 1924, President Calvin Coolidge was celebrating his birthday. In fact, Coolidge is the only American president to have been born on the 4th of July. And on this day in 1924, he was celebrating his 52nd birthday at the White House. To mark the occasion, he received a nearly 6-foot-tall floral arrangement from the Florist Telegraphers Association. President Coolidge was born at Plymouth, Vermont. Newspapers pointed out that while he was turning 52, the country was turning 148. And one newspaper headline said, "Cal's cool and 52. The Wilkes-Barre Record reported, "The president made no unusual observance of his birthday, but joined with the nation in the July 4th celebration. He spoke in the morning before the National Education Association, and then later in the day, he planned to board the presidential yacht, the Mayflower, for a cruise down the Potomac. There were no White House guests, although the two sons of the president and Mrs. Coolidge, John and Calvin Jr., were at home. E.T. Clark, the private secretary to the president, said more than 46,000 cards and letters of congratulation had been received. Today, if you Google Calvin Coolidge, 1924 birthday, you'll see him standing on the south lawn next to a very large floral arrangement that was delivered to the White House. Now, 3 days after his birthday, Coolidge and his family suffered a personal tragedy. His younger son and namesake, Calvin Jr., developed an infected blister, and he died from sepsis on July 7th, just 3 days later. And although Coolidge became depressed, the public voted him into office. He won a 3-way race and the popular vote by 2.5 million votes over his two opponents' combined totals. Thanks for listening to The Daily Gardener. And remember, for a happy, healthy life, garden every day. The Daily Gardener is produced in lovely Wyoming, Minnesota, with the help of Paige Mance, Brooke Bierbaum, Kiana Rayleigh, Maddie Doyle, Natalie Decker, and Eric Begay. You can find The Daily Gardener on all your favorite social media. You can follow the show on Instagram, and listeners always have a standing invitation to join the free Facebook group for the show. Just search for Daily Gardener Community the next time you're on Facebook and request to join. All the stories and books that are featured on the show can be found over at thedailygardener.org, thedailygardener.org. And while you're there, be sure to sign up for my free Friday newsletter. Last but not least, you can share your own gardener greetings on the show by emailing me at jennifer@thedailygardener.org. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and as always, have a great day in the garden, and we'll see you tomorrow.